Joining us right now is former Navy SEAL and spokesman for the pro-Trump Great America PAC, Carl Higbee. Carl, great to see you.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks so much for joining us. Your reaction to Hillary Clinton there, getting tougher against Donald Trump.
Well, she's trying, at least. I mean, look, the thing is she's going to call him unqualified. Look at what's happened under her reign. We've had the rise of ISIS. We've had massive destabilization of the markets in Europe. Hillary Clinton's foreign policy has been a disaster to date, and that's why Mr. Trump is the fresh breath of air. Like, he's going to come in and say, look, I didn't want to go into Iraq in the first place. I'll go into a war if I absolutely have to, but look, I don't want to go into foreign wars with no goals.
Yeah. You wonder what resonates with people, right, this November. Is it a failed strategy on foreign policy, or is it let's take a risk on someone who doesn't have the experience close to the White House?
Absolutely. I mean, it's crazy how you have someone like Hillary Clinton standing up there saying he's unqualified, yet she was part of giving Iran back billions and billions of dollars through the trade deal. And Donald Trump is going in saying, look, America first, America strength, project peace through strength. What's so bad about that?
Where Hill went, because again, he won the Republican nomination in part because he didn't have a nuanced way of talking about fighting ISIS.
Yeah.
And when you get into the weeds, that was not resonating with voters. But one thing, I listened to that speech, almost every word of it, she did not talk about over and over again radical Islamic terrorism.
She didn't say it again.
She did not. I did not hear her say it. So if she said it, my apologies. But she did not talk about who the enemy is. And I think that's going to be a glaring point that he can hit over and over and over again.
I don't understand this, why they can't say the words. It's just extraordinary.
Yeah. She has a different audience, though, here, Carl. Does that make a difference? I mean, she's not talking to Republicans. She's talking to Sanders supporters.
Right.
She's talking to sort of moderates
on the side.
I mean, does that matter here in terms of Trump's response?
Yeah, I mean, she's talking to a completely different audience. But look, those people at her rallies are not going to come out and vote for Trump anyway. So she's catering to a base that's ever decreasing. And the other thing, too, is you look at what she's doing. She's talking about how Trump is going to destabilize things. These are Hillary's supporters, Hillary's base, that are going out to places like these Donald Trump rallies, burning American flags, flipping over motorcade cars.
Terrible.
You know, throwing. I mean, it is disgusting.
Yeah.
This is the base of Hillary Clinton. She's calling Donald Trump divisive.
Where are Sanders and Clinton and calling out these protesters and saying, stop it?
Yeah. They're funding it.
Stop it.
Why don't we hear him say that? Why don't we hear any leadership? Who's taking the lead here?
Because they're trying to incite violence.
They want it.
Ultimately, that they want something bad to happen within a Donald Trump rally, because then they'll pin it on him, which has actually been the American, the way the Obama administration talked about America and liberals. Somehow we brought terrorism on this.
Right.
Somehow you bring violence on this because of the language that you use. I think the Americans patently reject that.
Witness the apology tour after all of that. How about this? New reports that a smuggling network based in Brazil is bringing in illegal immigrants from the Middle East to Mexico, just miles from the U.S. border. Now, immigration officials say that at least one dozen men have been smuggled into the Western Hemisphere, and at least of one of those men has been connected to an attack plot on North America. Carl, we've got the evidence. They're coming. They're coming through Mexico, and now there's the smuggling group out of Brazil.
Yeah, Donald Trump's wall doesn't seem like such a bad idea now.
Right.
Also, the fact we need to look at, too, is through the Syrian refugee crisis, what we're seeing now is, we saw, you know, last month we had a little over 1,000 people come through as Syrian refugees, okay? Two of them were Christian. Two people. The rest were all Muslim. This is a problem we need to look at, and who is coming over to this country, who is being vetted, what their beliefs are, and why they're coming here. And they're coming through through this border illegally now.
There were three arrests of potential ISIS terrorists who were plotting an attack on Dusseldorf, Germany, and one of them came in through the refugee program.
Exactly.
You've seen that. There was an arrest of a couple who were in Berlin who were plotting a terror attack. So when people raise issues about the refugees coming here, completely valid.
And
that's the thing. I mean, the ISIS got a passport-making machine. You know, so they have obviously tried to infiltrate the refugee program.
They're going to take advantage of any way they can to try to get people in the country that are going to be able to, you know, really carry out terrorist attacks. So anything, whether it's, you know, wherever they're sneaking them in, they're going to take advantage in any way.
And I think you're right. This sort of lends credence to the wall idea. But, you know, there's so many Americans who are skeptical of that rhetoric. Is there a way for Trump to broaden that a little bit and talk? See, we've got a real problem to solve. Look, you may not resonate with the wall, but I'm the guy who can actually do something about it.
What's wrong with the wall? I mean, what's wrong with borders and protecting the borders?
Yeah, I think the rhetoric just doesn't resonate with a lot of Americans, but they do want to solve this problem. So the question is, can you actually bring more people in using this kind of data?
Exactly. What I tell people, too, is they're like, well, the wall's not going to work. It's like, do you leave your front door unlocked in your home? No, of course not. You lock your door because you don't want people who aren't supposed to be there.
Right.
So, I mean, what is so wrong with protecting our nation's borders, which is, by the way, the law anyway, which President Obama has failed to do by endorsing places like San Francisco with the sanctuary cities and things like that. Let's protect our country. We know it's happening. Look, Trump wanted to ban ban Muslims. Realistically, what he meant by that is, hey, look, let's take a greater look at the mass populations that are immigrating here, and let's start profiling people because that's the intelligent way to narrow it down.
And that platform has resonated and enabled him to raise money. So let's get back to the election for a second, because Donald Trump making comments yesterday on the millions of dollars he's invested into his own campaign. Watch this.
In the primaries, I spent $55 million of my money. And in fact, somebody said, I guess for legal purposes, they put it down as a loan, where I loaned myself $55 million. I will say to you tonight, I've been saying it all the time, I'm going to determine I don't even want it as a loan. I don't even know why. When somebody does it, they always put it down as a loan. I'm not paying myself back. We're wiping out that loan. I'm in for $55 million.
So now, Carl, super PACs like your super PAC, yep, raising millions of dollars for Donald Trump, he says he's funding himself. Your take, and how much money have you been able to raise for Donald Trump so far?
So our group, Great America PAC, is right around $3 million. Right now we have additional pledges for significantly more. There's another number of other PACs popping up right now, but right now we are the primary force. We've spent $2.5 on this race alone. The other thing, too, is like, look, you cannot physically raise enough money to run and win for president just in $2,700 increments. It's just not possible. So it takes $1 billion to effectively run for president, and you're going to need to raise $700 million of that through super PACs and things like that. We're not, you know, doing handouts. We're not an employment farm. We're not doing this just because we like it. We're doing it because we want to see Mr. Trump elected. And when you have, all these groups popping up, we're all on the same team. We all want the same guy elected. So, you know what? We encourage people to get in. Also, the campaign rules of finance are so screwed up. Donald Trump had to take money out of his personal account, put in his campaign account, and then pay himself back for the use of his jet. I mean, these are the kind of things that he's running to try to change.
Right. Yeah. Interesting. Some people say that he'll only need like $500 million. You think it will be? He'll need $1 billion.
I mean, he won a primary on effectively less than anybody in recent history.
Yeah.
So,
Carl, good to see you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Carl Higbie joining us there. Straight ahead.